Today, the U.S. Census Bureau released a report looking at the accuracy of its 2020 population count and whether it missed key groups of people across the country. Lisa Desjardins has more.
Judy, after review, the census found miscounts with multiple groups. The official census number overcounted two groups, non-Hispanic whites and Asians, but it undercounted blacks, Native Americans living on reservations, and Hispanics by even more. To talk more about those miscounts and what they mean, I'm joined by NPR national correspondent Hansi Lo Wang. Hansi, let's just start with those overcounts and undercounts, especially the undercounts. Exactly how large were they? What are we talking about here?
We're talking about undercounts that for Latinos, more than three times the net undercount rate compared to 2010. That's a dramatic increase. And for Black people and for Native Americans living on reservations, they are numerically higher net undercount rates, but the Census Bureau says they're not statistically any different. But still, the bottom line here is that there is this racial gap between people of color, generally speaking, and people who identify as white and not Hispanic. And for what is also interesting is that you do see an overcounting of Asian Americans, which was not seen in 2010. And just to be clear, it's also not clear exactly how well the Census Bureau did in counting Pacific Islanders.
I want to play the sound, some of the concerns that we heard from some of these groups today. Listen to some of this.
Some 4 million plus, maybe as many as 5 million, Black people have been missed. And perhaps an equal number of people of Hispanic and Latino descent have been missed is a tragedy and an act of near malfeasance and incompetence.
Today we learned that this census was really a five-alarm fire when it comes to Latinos. The undercount of Latinos has tripled between 2010 and 2020. And I think that has significant implications for the entire country.
Not just concern there, you and I were both on the call with the Census Bureau. There seemed to be some anger from some of these groups as well. Can you help us understand why is this happening? What do we know about why some groups in the official census number just are not counted as they really exist?
This is a long-standing flaw with census numbers going back decades. This trend is not new. And what is new is that in 2020, we had the pandemic, coronavirus. Just as counting was getting really started nationwide, the outbreaks were happening. And we had years of interference from former President Donald Trump's administration, beginning most notably with that failed push to add a citizenship question to the forms. It did not end up on the forms, but it stirred up a lot of controversy, a lot of fear, a lot of uncertainty from a lot of households, especially those with immigrants living in them, of whether or not to participate in the census. And then during counting in 2020, the former President Donald Trump's administration ended counting early. All of these factors raised the risk of undercounting people of color because research has shown that the way to get those groups counted is through that person-to-person interaction, in-person door-knocking interviews, not necessarily counting on households to fill out a form and to essentially participate in the census on their own. And so that's a really major factors here of why we're seeing a really bad report card in many ways for the Census Bureau.
Racial groups are not, the only demographic. And in this census, this review also found that another group was undercounted significantly, children under the age of 5. We reached out to a children's advocate to talk about what exactly they think that means, their concern there.
Probably the most important reason this matters for young children and for children in general is that there's about $1.5 trillion given out by the federal government to states and localities every year. That's $15 trillion over 10 years that the census data is used. And that buys a lot of things like schools and childcare and playgrounds, things that kids need.
In both of these areas, for kids and also for different racial groups in this country, can you help us understand what's at stake? What does the miscount in the census really mean in real lives?
When we're talking about the census, we are talking about power, we are talking about money. These are the numbers used to reallocate each state's share of congressional seats, electoral college votes. They're being used to redraw voting maps for every level of government across the country. And these are numbers used to help guide the distribution of some $1.5 trillion a year for healthcare, for transportation, for education, almost all public services. And so when there are these racial inequities baked in terms of the accuracy of these counts, you're going to have racial inequities baked into the decision making, into how power, political power is shared, how federal funding is shared. And, you know, we're not even talking about how researchers, businesses rely on this data to have just a basic general understanding of who is living in the United States of America. And based on these undercount rates and overcount rates that the census put out today, it's another point of evidence here that these numbers aren't true reflections of exactly who is living in the country.
Hansi, in our last 30 seconds or so, what next? Are these numbers final? I know some groups are thinking about court action, but are these numbers final now?
Well, these numbers have already been used to reallocate those congressional seats, electoral college votes. They're already being used to redraw voting maps. The Census Bureau, one of the Census Bureau officials did confirm to me today that the Bureau is looking into possibly doing some more research and how to use these over and undercounting rates and to factor them into upcoming population estimates. And those estimates help guide how that federal funding is distributed. So that could have some potential impact here on maybe a more equitable distribution of federal funding. But it is a real big question of just how a lot of local communities, when they look at their numbers and they feel like they're not quite an accurate reflection of who's living in their communities, it's a big question of what actually can be done beyond waiting for the 2030 census.
Hansi Lo Wang, NPR, and our census guru, thank you so much.
You're welcome.